Hello and welcome to Collect, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the VIP programme for the 2021 edition. As part of the VIP experience, we're very pleased to welcome Cox London as one of its supporters. And I'm here in the Crafts Council Gallery, surrounded by beautiful work, but also by some amazing furniture from Cox London. I'm delighted to introduce a film, a beautiful film that they have made for Collect for this year, which is called The Collectors, Modern Craft in the Hands of Interior Designers. Editor of House and Garden magazine, Hatta Byng, will be asking interior designers how handmade, well-crafted and unique objects find their place in an interior. Enjoy the film. Thank you.
Chris, how do you see your work? Are you craftsmen, artists, designers? How do you describe it?
By virtue of having gone to art school and studied fine art, we think of ourselves first and foremost as sculptors.
Right.
But we work so much with craftspeople. We have an amazing team of craftspeople, of other artisans, technicians and engineers. So we encompass more than that.
Yeah.
And it's hard to be called just artist, yeah.
And when you start to kind of have an idea for a new piece, does that come from a sort of filling a gap in the collection? We haven't got side tables, or does it come from an idea or from a material, from a process, from a motif? What usually?
I wish we were organized enough to be thinking filling gaps, but usually we're making what inspires us next,
right.
And it might be related to something we've already made, but it very seldom is. It's a fresh idea, and it's from the page, or in Nikki's case, it might be from a narrative, something she's reading about. So it's a fine artist approach, and we don't necessarily think about the function straight away,
right?
But it does make its way into a functional item in some sense, in most senses.
Yeah. Yes, I mean, ultimately, you're creating functional pieces, aren't you, by and large?
Yeah, we are, 90% of the time. Although one would argue the chandeliers that we make are very sculptural, and sometimes we're fortunate enough that a lighting designer is throwing light onto them and they're not supplying light for the room. So very fortunate in that they are sculptural pieces hanging in the middle of a room.
And what do you feel a handcrafted piece brings to a room, to an interior?
I subscribe to the idea that an interior should be landscaped. And that is, bring a natural line, bring something from outdoors in. For me, that's what brings an energy, a natural energy to the room. So a handcrafted piece does everything to counter the straight lines of a modern or straight, handsome architectural space. And it breaks free from that, and it gives an energy. I love a piece that feels like it's so animated it might hop up and walk away.
And they have this sort of spirit of the maker and the idea, I suppose, within them, don't they? But
so much so. And so much is about the handmade element, and the surface brings attention to the room and a personality that belongs to the maker. Yeah, I think that's really important.
Yeah. And are there interior designers that you particularly sort of love how they use handcrafted pieces within their work?
There are lots, so many of the designers we work with understand that to bring a natural line, a handmade object into a space, there's so much for a space. Collections, curating spaces in that sense. One of the interior designers that I truly revere and think is a force in our world is Axel Vavour, who definitely brings the outside in, and he also brings time-warp materials in to a space, and he gives great antiquities perfect homes in a space.
Looking around us, nature is obviously a huge influence on your work and on your pieces. Is that always been the case? That's a starting point, I presume.
I don't think we can help but be inspired by it. I think in interiors ever since we've been making dwellings and living indoors as human beings, we've been bringing the outside in, and we haven't stopped. And we never made the decision that we're, you know, we're only going to make things inspired by the natural world. I think, you know, I just have. And, you know, 15 years on, we've got this collection of things that maybe everything has got a link to, and we're only just realizing that, but in a sense, it's just come to the fore naturally. And I think it does in design anyway. I don't think it's, we've got an exclusive on that at all.
No, a lot of your pieces have come from you, but you're also working with interior designers. How often would you start from scratch with them on a design, or is it tend to be working on ideas you've already had?
I think a designer always gets the best of us when they've spotted a piece in our collection that they like. And then taking it to another place. It suits the way we work as craftspeople. It suits the materials we're already familiar with,
of course,
and suits our design aesthetic and our eye. So we work to our best. So if someone's taking a small chandelier or a branch of something that we've made before and saying, let's expand that or even shrink it, we're in a comfortable place.
Yes. And why did you get involved with Collect? Why, what has kind of started that whole involvement with them?
We were asked as a group of makers and actually gallerists in Pimlico 2 years ago to help dress the VIP space. And Nikki and I enjoyed that, and our team enjoyed that so much, producing objects specifically for Collect, not least because there's hundreds of kindred spirits there. The gallerists appreciate a well handmade piece, and then everyone they're represented is making with their hands. So suddenly we're surrounded by kindred spirits. So that private view and meeting makers and talking shop opened up a world that we'd almost not unpacked for a while, almost since college. So that really kind of refueled us, good energy,
Brilliant. And going as a maker and an artist to Collect, what are you looking for when you're looking, you know, going around the galleries and looking at the pieces? What are you drawn to?
You almost don't have to look, do you? No. Things find you and pop out. No. And I think it's probably the most relaxed I am in any exhibition. It's one of my favorite exhibitions in the calendar. I walk around and literally it's a feast for the eyes. And I just feel an overwhelming appreciation for the ceramicist doing something that I've never been able to do, or the glassmaker blowing, casting, kiln forming something, a process I know something about but I've never been able to do, that really excites me straight away, that was surrounded by work of excellent makers, of master makers.
And this year, which pieces are the pieces that you're looking forward to seeing?
The three pieces I picked were by Ikuko Iwamoto, who's a Japanese maker in London. She creates the most incredible ceramics, mind-bogglingly complex as far as manufacturing process goes. She uses slip casting, enormous amount of repetitive work, dots and spikes. And she's a maker's maker, but she's truly an artist. You know, her imagination and the surrealist approach to her work, so unique. So I picked three pieces by her.
So they're not functional pieces at all, really, are they? Well, in fact, the pieces you've picked are sort of taking functional objects and making them completely kind of pieces of art, I suppose.
That's what I really love about them, is it's art trouvé, and then she's taken it to another place. So I've picked a hoe, a garden hoe, a mallet and a scoop, all of which have been adorned with thousands of little spines in ceramic, which are then gilded on the tips and arranged amazingly to take these things to another world. The scoop has almost like a sea anemone. I see it as it could be very prickly and spiky and dangerous, but I see it almost as a soft thing. I imagine, I think it's very animated. I love that about it. And also the fact that it's been put in an antique scoop, which is rather beautiful in its own right, but you're almost, you're invited to hold the scoop and observe this thing like you would something in a rock ball.
Yes, exactly.
The fact that I'm from an antique dealing background and I see these objects, I've seen these objects for years at art fairs and antiques fairs, and you can pick up an antique scoop and love it, or an antique hoe, or an antique mallet she's picked as well. These are all objects you see, but what Ikuko does with them is completely takes them to another place. The mallet is rendered almost like, it looks like a ritualistic object with spikes coming out at either end. So you can't use it.
No, definitely not. It would shatter.
And that's how I feel about it as well. I don't feel so much about that it's dangerous. I worry for the spikes, that somebody might pick it up and break these wonderful, delicate spikes that she's fashioned in ceramic. And then the hoe, which is a gardener, I know takes a lot of effort. You have to grab it with both hands, and pull it in the ground, and you can't do that. The handle is the one with spikes either side, so you can't physically pick this hoe up.
Absolutely.
Really interesting work, really.
How do you display craft, and what is to you is a sort of ideal way of living with craft?
I've always been drawn to collections, to gallery collections that are in somebody's home, the collector's home, or a house, a domestic setting. So when I think about the Guggenheim in Venice, which I saw when I was young and was completely blown away by this collection that Peggy Guggenheim had, and then it'd been recurated by somebody else in her house. But when you see Alexander Calder's bedhead fashioned in silver, and it was made for her bed, maybe in the room that it's exhibited in, but with her pets buried in the back garden, and the Grand Canal and the boats in the front garden, all this movement outside in a domestic setting, you get a sense of the collector. And that's true as well, I think, of the Historic in Islington, which is a Georgian townhouse.
Yes, I know, absolutely.
It's beautiful, and I particularly love Italian Futurists and all of that postmodern work as well. That's an era that I love, and that's an amazing house to visit, which I think is great. And then Kettle's Yard, I think, for me, is the finest example that I always come back to. Jimmy and his wife lived in that house, and they curated their collection as they wanted to live with it, and that's how it remains. So I think, if we flip that the other way, and I want an interior like that, I have to become curator and collector.
And it's a feeling of a narrative building of its own, building up through all the different pieces that have been collected to create an interior, isn't it?
Completely. You can't argue with it. It's somebody's heartfelt collection. He knew the artists as well, and the makers, many of them. And it's really honest to him and his life collecting and how he enjoyed the pieces. And you get a slice of that when you move into, you sit in a Windsor chair in his house and enjoy the objects. That's how I'd love to live with craft. Yeah.
That's how I'd like to live too. That would be an ambition.
Yes.
Olivia, what sort of role does craft play in your interiors, or the idea of beautifully crafted pieces?
Well, it's such a lovely question, because craft's important to me, not just in interiors, but in my whole life, I think.
Right.
Yeah, right from childhood, where my mum is very creative and encouraged us, me and my two sisters, to be very creative too. And we actually had 5 sewing machines dotted around the house. And one was an old-fashioned treadle sewing machine. And she encouraged us to do things a bit differently. So we actually stitched through paper as well as cloth.
Right.
And offcuts of leather and things like that. And really, we made things from every weekend.
Okay.
A bit of screen printing, lots of creative stuff. Which was the perfect start for me, really, because then I moved on to Colfax and Fowler, which is after university, which was, so passionate about craft and bespoke commissions.
Yes.
And then Sewn Britain as well, where Lulu champions craftsmanship in Britain. So craft is all through me.
Yeah, absolutely. And
from
your
the
knowledge
start.
Of craft, I mean, from working at Sewn and crafts people all over the country. You've got a huge knowledge of who to go to for what, I suppose.
Absolutely, who to go to for what. But if I work with a new artisan craftsperson, it really is such a joy because you learn something new each time. Yeah.
And is it scary working with somebody
completely new?
Completely new.
I think there's a lot of fear with interior design.
Yeah.
I have a feeling that when you lose the fear, perhaps the projects don't go so well, interestingly, because I think a bit of fear does drive you.
Yeah. Is it frightening working with new people that you've never worked with before?
Yes. I think interior design is quite frightening, actually, yes. Hatta.
I certainly remember that from my time.
I think that it's hard to visualise a space and how it will really be. Mm. You can draw it a million times, but there's always an element of surprise, and that really is one of the most joyful parts of the job, actually.
Yeah.
To work with new craftspeople, new artisans, create rooms and see what they look like and take your clients with you on that journey.
Yeah, absolutely. And do you think having had a sort of background in and a sort of an innate understanding of making helps you to commission people?
Most definitely. I think it's really important and fun to get to know the person who's making something for you.
Yeah.
Let the ideas develop. Don't be too prescriptive. And I think that the ideas will flow. And because I'm so passionate about it anyway myself, I get really involved and really excited.
Yeah.
I'm not brilliant at making anything, but I certainly like to get involved and see how it's done.
Yes, and working with these craftsmen is the next best thing to making it yourself in a way, isn't it?
Yeah,
you're part of the vision, I suppose.
Yes, you're absolutely right. And it's just such a learning curve as well. It's really fascinating to see things being made, how long they take.
Yeah.
It's very humbling, actually, to realise that a beautiful, I don't know, a rattan lampshade, for example, really has taken perhaps a week to make of somebody's time every day, 8 hours a day.
Yeah.
It makes you love that piece all the more.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And what do you feel these pieces bring to an interior? To a room?
Gosh, so much. I think that if a room had a recipe, I think that one thing in that room should always be a handmade, crafted, beautiful piece.
Yeah.
And don't worry about budget here, because if you think crafts have to be expensive, they actually don't.
Yeah.
They can still add so much to a room, and actually everything is there then enhanced.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. And what sort of crafts people do you sort of gravitate towards to work with your projects?
I use some really fabulous people to make things, and we're sitting at here at Cox workshop, so it's I have to say I have worked with Cox a few times on some beautiful bespoke pieces, and really enjoyed it. So Cox is absolutely high up on the list. Also, I've worked with Sewn Britain, of course, and have made a beautiful piece with them. It was a card table, actually, with a beautiful leather top, and the cards didn't sort of slide around. It was really perfect for girls' daytime sitting room that we made it for, really pretty hand stitching.
And I suppose the joy there is it enables you to get exactly what you want to make
exactly
and tailor it
exactly. And it's fun because every step of the way you're working with the client too, looking at all the samples, drawing, going back and forth with the workshop as well, and in the end the client has something that nobody else has. And you walk into that room, you think, wow, that's actually something a bit different over there. Lovely.
When you go to somewhere like Collect, or particularly to Collect, where do you, what do you find yourself gravitating towards in terms of pieces? Is there a medium? Is it pieces with a narrative? Is it a kind of a process? What pulls you in?
Yeah, it's such a nice question, because I think the process and the narrative is almost as important, actually, as the finished product. And I love it envisaging how did this person start with this piece, and how did they make it, and how long did it take to make it? I think I sometimes gravitate towards textile design.
Right.
Maybe because of my background and my job. I love textiles.
Yeah.
And I love touching them. I find them very tactile. I love seeing how they're stitched.
Yeah. And do you often kind of buy them for projects at some hang or
Yeah, I do buy textiles for projects, and sometimes we decide to stretch them over a frame. Sometimes we might make them into sort of sliding doors between two rooms.
Right.
Obviously, we use them as upholstery as well, in a more usual way too.
Yeah. And what particularly this year has caught your eye at Collect?
Gosh, good question. So much.
Yeah.
I particularly love the work. It's a ceramicist, Vicky Lindo.
Right.
She's known for Cats and Clay. Really fabulous cats.
Okay.
Really humorous, very intricately designed, lovely illustration. And if I was to own one of those pieces, I think I'd put it somewhere where I could really gaze at it.
Yeah.
So not in the entrance hall where you just sort of whiz by really quickly, but more like in a bathroom or something where you're actually relaxing in the bathtub and,
and get real joy from it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And sort of look at all the detail.
Yeah. And then I know also that you've kind of spotted the tapestry by Gary Fabian Miller, isn't it?
Yes. Gary Fabian Miller. Yeah.
Tell us why that has caught your eye.
Well, it is mesmerizing. I think we're all, English people are always so obsessed with the weather, aren't they? I mean, it really does look like the sun. It also looks like the moon. It is reverberating. Mm. It's just incredible,
this
piece.
Yeah, it's very powerful.
Yeah. It sort of reminds me, makes me think of the artist Oliver Eliasson, who did the weather in the Tate Modern.
Right. Okay.
And also Anish Kapoor. You know, it's that kind of large scale, hugely eye-catching piece that, I mean, it's kind of blown me away, really. It is actually called a hearth rug.
Yes, sorry, I realise it's not a tapestry at all. It's a rug, isn't
it? It's a hearth rug, but I would never put it on the floor, ever. it has to be wall hung.
Yeah.
It should be wall hung where you can stand back and look at it. Maybe you can walk towards it or something.
Yes, you just wouldn't get it on a floor, would you, in the same way, which is fascinating. I wonder why he called them hearth rugs.
It's quite snuggly. I have touched it. It's wool. It's hand-tufted wool. So maybe you would, maybe you'd want to have it on the floor, but you need to really see this piece to appreciate it, and I think that wall hung is the place for it. It's lovely.
It's kind of very powerful, and I love the idea that it's a photographer having their work translated into a totally different medium.
I love
that
too. Lucky him.
Exactly.
And he's had it made by Dovecot Studios, and they're really talented, aren't they?
So it's amazing.
That's really, really nice.
Yeah. And what about in your own, do you live with craft yourself?
I live with handmade pieces all over the place. So yes, handmade is craft. I love designing shelves at the moment. Everybody needs more storage. It doesn't matter how big your house is, you always need more storage. And I designed some shelves which I have in my sitting room, which I love them so much, showed them to a client and then he wanted them. They've changed a bit, but we've installed them now and he's happy. And I kind of see these shelves developing for various different clients, actually. So I do like to be surrounded by handmade things.
Absolutely. And I think you were telling me that you're also kind of working on your own collection of ceramics. Is that right?
Yes, I'm quite passionate about ceramics. Not really in the form that you expect. So I love pots, I love dishes, I love vases, but actually I'm quite interested in ceramic tops for tables.
Right.
If you imagine a tabletop that normally you drop a sort of disc of marble on top of, for example, I want to work towards having discs of ceramic that you can just pop onto, say, a metal table structure. And also I like ceramic mirror frames. So watch this space, really. It's definitely a work in progress, a sketchbook project at the moment. Haven't made anything
yet. A
gem
of an idea at the moment.
Yeah, I need somebody to help me with this.
Absolutely. Brilliant. Hugh, do you live with pieces of craft at home? Are you a collector at all?
Am I a collector? Yes, I love art. I love decorative arts, art. Yeah, they're all they're vital to making a house a home, I think.
So what do they bring to a room? Why are they important?
Something which is human and something which is hopefully tactile, something which is visual, and something which you can relate to, because houses and spaces can be well designed and furnished and kitted out,
Yeah.
But unless you've got things of artistic interest and crafts and things which fascinate and draw you in, it's really the make or break between something, a space which is, whether it be commercial or residential, between which is something which is interesting and intriguing and livable, and something which isn't.
Yes, so, absolutely. Yeah. They sort of take add a whole another layer of narrative, I suppose, to an interior.
Entirely. Yeah. You know, without objects, art objects, space just, you know, whatever it's meant to be, just doesn't work really.
Yeah. And what do you find you gravitating to?
I love ceramics. Yeah. I've always loved ceramics. I used to think I might be a potter one day. In fact, I converted our garage into a studio a few years ago for the one day when I'm going to take up pottery, but anyway, I haven't quite got there yet. But I love pottery.
Yeah.
I love weaving as well.
Right.
I love what else?
And how would you incorporate weaving into an?
There are different artists. You know, the simplest things like baskets. I love African baskets. Yes. You know, an arrangement or just a couple of beautiful coloured African baskets, which you know, can be terribly affordable.
Yeah.
Can bring something which is interesting. They're colourful. The texture is interesting.
Yeah.
And there are various artists who do wonderful woven objects. So it's not a bowl, but they're just like a bird's. Some of them look like a bird's nest, but they're just so. I think they're so interesting and they're so beautiful, and some of them are so delicate.
Yeah.
There's one artist who I love called Shona Rendell, and she does beautiful, very delicate woven objects.
Right.
Sure, you can describe them, and they can sit on a coffee table. You can put them on a shelf, and some of her things you can actually hang on walls.
Yeah.
So. It's really entirely what, you know, depends what the artist has created.
Yeah. I mean, what's interesting is, you know, your interiors are very kind of highly crafted and designed and curated. But I suppose by adding these pieces, they're out of your, you know, they're a totally different story that you haven't had any hand in.
Exactly. You know, exactly. Sometimes, you know, a client will bring their own things to their project, which is fantastic because it's their house. So quite rightly that they should bring things along, and they just add another dimension, which, and if it's something which I haven't considered, it's often so much the better, you know, because it's, and then it becomes a space or a home for the people who are going to be living there rather than my project.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And do you take clients shopping, or how do you kind of?
Definitely. Yeah. You know, shopping with clients is sort of the icing on the cake, really. And you know, it tends to happen later on a project where you've been through the design phase, where you've done the planning, you've been through the building project, you've chosen the furniture and the furnishings. So choosing artistic objects and crafts is really it's the icing on the cake. So, you know, that's always, by then you've established a relationship with your client, and so there's an element of trust.
Yeah.
So it's great fun, you know, to go shopping and find beautiful things to place in the house.
And have you taken them to collect?
I've been to collect, sorely miss it, for the obvious reasons recently. But Collect is a fantastic fair, and they have such a variety of well-considered artists. I love Collect.
Yeah. And are there particular galleries you find within Collect that you find yourself?
Yes, you always have a few. You just come from the past, you know, when you've wandered around one year and you've ended up making some successful purchases, you're naturally going to be drawn back to those dealers, and you look out for them next time around.
Yeah.
But there's always, you know, it's a visual thing. So immediately if your eye catches upon something, or your client catches upon something or other which appeals, then fantastic, away you go. So it's, what's wonderful about it is because there are so many different artists, or so many artists encompassed under one roof.
Yeah.
So it makes makes that element of the project so much easier because, you know, we can all scroll through the internet, but there's nothing like seeing something in reality.
No, and you can sort of, I presume, walk around, sort of have a shortlist, and then kind of edit from there before you.
Yeah.
So it's a very informed purchase,
Isn't it? exactly. And it's exciting too because, you know, if your client or something you see appeals, you can always find a space for something beautiful. It's like, you know, you can never have too many paintings because so buying new things is great because it gives you the opportunity to rehang things, move objects around, reorganize the bookshelves.
Absolutely,
so you can never have too many things.
And what this year has caught your eye from Collect?
Well, I love the piece by Daniel, Mobile. And it caught my attention. I love the scale of it. It's, you know, it is a very big scale, and obviously pieces of a larger scale are less easy to incorporate into a home.
Where would you hang it?
It needs to be in a high ceiling, obviously. I've got an artist's studio, and it would look fantastic coming from my from my ceiling, you know, because high ceilings often are great places for chandeliers, and chandeliers are wonderful, but a mobile piece of art, I think, is just adds another dimension.
And would you light it in a certain way? Would it require lighting? Or?
Everything has to be lit, doesn't it? But it doesn't. I don't think, you know, it looks beautiful as it is right now. I don't think it needs to be. The daylight on all those different planes and surfaces is absolutely beautiful. The way the light reflects off the rounded circles on the framework of the cube is absolutely wonderful. And then the way the light falls on the planes of the disc and the cruciform. I think just here, just with natural daylight, looks absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, and so, it has huge presence in a room, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Yeah, it's quite demanding, but it's rather peaceful as well.
Yeah.
It's not too shouty.
No, it's definitely, it's not shouty, but it's strong.
it's certainly strong.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I think it's beautiful.
And do you work with craftspeople to commission? I mean, do you commission craft?
Occasionally. Yeah. You obviously, if you're going to commission someone, it's possibly someone whose work you've bought before, because then you have an understanding. You've already liked their work, so that's one big hurdle achieved.
Yes.
Yes,
because it's a little bit more scary. Going down that route.
It's a bit like having a suit made. You're never quite sure. Is it going to turn out with those choices which we put together on a sketchbook or looking at samples, were they the right choices? So there's obviously an advantage to seeing something and immediately loving it and thinking, yes, we have to have that.
Yeah.
But commissioning things is very exciting because it allows the artist and the purchaser, whether it's me or a client, to create something individual. So there are opportunities certainly in commissioning things.
Yeah, and what sort of people do you return
there's a potter who I've commissioned to make pots which I change to lamp bases.
Brilliant.
Which lamp bases are, we all need them, and they're rather, you have to light a room. I still think lamps are one of the nicest ways of lighting a room, and a lamp base is beautifully lit, obviously, so it's a perfect opportunity to, for a beautiful pot to be a piece of art and crafts to be incorporated in a room, which is something which is useful as well. So lamp bases are sort of a no-brainer because that we all need them, and it's just lovely to come across something which is individual.
Yes, and you're combining a kind of piece of art or craft with a function.
So away you go.
And do you I imagine you are commissioning or designing pieces of furniture and kind of using cabinet makers, joiners to do that sort of thing, because your interiors often incorporate sort of very bespoke pieces of furniture. So in that way, I mean, maybe it's a different sort of working relationship, because you're presumably very prescriptive in that sort of way.
So when we design furniture for projects, yes, we obviously design the piece of furniture, whether it's a bookcase or a table or a center table. You design the piece of furniture, timber, veneer, how you're going to polish, bleach, stain, patinate, all those choices. And then the object which comes on it will often be a total contrast.
Yeah.
You know, you'll be offsetting something which is terribly, a totally different finish, texture, the way it reflects light, which is totally contrast to the piece of furniture we're sitting on. So that's the exciting thing about wandering around fairs such as Collect, is that you can immediately see, a huge choice of objects to consider.
Yeah. And build up your composition. I mean, your room is like a...
Exactly. Yeah. And sometimes it's great fun. You're with a client and you might get a bit carried away and excited and buy, an amazing number of beautiful things. Yeah. And then it's it's a great puzzle to work out how you're going to display them in a home, to move things around. And as I said earlier, things can be moved around as well. Yeah. They don't need to be kinetics. They don't have to be fixed. You can move them around as much as you like.
Yeah.
So, and often things, we like to think that we can visualize and make good judgment, but often in reality, when you start placing things, what you perceived as might have been a good idea isn't.
Yes.
So, things have to be reconsidered, and you have to sort of move things around and juggle, but that's part of the fun.
Yes, and that it's not, what you designed right at the beginning isn't necessarily
how it ends up. And that's where all these beautiful pieces coming in create different dialogues and relationships. And that's when it's exciting.
There's planning, you know, we all have to plan and work things out, but in reality things can sometimes take a turn for the better.
But sometimes, presumably, is it quite difficult to let go of that original vision?
Yeah, it can be. It can be. Yeah. It can be.
Or if a client brings something that
for sure. You know, sometimes you get it rather attached to your concept or your idea. You know, there's another way of doing things. You know, there's lots of different ways of skinning a cat. So, you know, how do you, you know, embrace the present and as things progress and you know, organically grow, how do you sort of go with it and actually perhaps progress to something which wasn't what you originally conceived. Exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. What does craft mean to you personally?
I've been thinking about this a lot, and I think really it started when I was younger, because my father has always been very artistic. He would make things. So he was a potter, and he had a potter's wheel, and he used to make bowls and objects that we would have at home. It's very special to me. So to this day, even as an adult, I have that from my father that he made for me. And he gave me a gift of a wooden bench that he made by himself, with no mechanical fixings. And it's just, it's very much him. And it's not necessarily me. And actually, the way that he made the legs, I definitely wouldn't have chosen it. But then I wouldn't have told him what to do either. So I love it because it means it's dad.
Yeah.
And there's some things about it that I do love, but there's other things that's just dad. And so that's why it's so special to me.
Yeah, and I suppose because you also are understanding a sense of the person's hand and them in a piece. So when you're looking at a pot or whatever, you're looking at it, kind of understanding it from your father's point of view of seeing it being made.
Completely really. Personal, yeah. Yes, yeah. Exactly. So it's almost when you look at any other piece that wasn't made by somebody you know, it feels very personal.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been touched by some sort of personality, some sort of character that's... especially even better when it's not your own, because then that represents something that you couldn't quite grasp yourself, but it gives that to you. So
and how did you live with them as a child, in your parents' house? How did they display them?
Well, I think my house was less one of display and one of use.
Right.
So it was more you sit on the bench and then you use the pot to put the apples in.
Yes, absolutely.
And we were a little bit less delicate with things. But then I think that I also like that approach because it means that you really live with things and they become part of your life rather than revering something too much that you're too careful and anxious around it. Yeah. So although there are definitely pieces that you have to be very careful with and never touch, but the ones that I had in my life were much more robust, let's say.
And when you go to somewhere like Collect, what is it that you kind of gravitate towards? I think we all have sort of things. What is it?
Different personal things. Okay, so what would my things be? I think I'm definitely very much into ceramics and pottery generally, maybe because of dad, has been something that I've always had a love for. And I also love hanging tapestries and woven pieces too. So I tend to go for those over and above everything else.
And because I know that you've chosen a piece by Peter Collingwood from that has sort of caught your eye from Collect this year.
Yeah.
Tell me a bit more about why that's caught your eye.
I think because it's such a graphic piece again. Yeah. So although there's that natural elements of the strung linen, it's actually very graphic, which appeals to me. It's that monochromatic, black and white feeling. And also, I think knowing what went into the work that he did and how he really, really loved working on the loom and let the loom lead the design rather than trying to impose his opinions on it, which I thought was a very strong concept.
Yeah.
But I think mostly from a very aesthetic perspective, it's the graphics of it that I really, really love.
And you can immediately imagine it hanging somewhere, presumably. Do you have a project in mind?
I can think of a lot of places. It's just a matter of phoning up the clients.
Yes.
Phoning up the right ones first.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And then you've also chosen a pot by Lucy Ree.
Yes.
And tell us that.
Well,
that.
She's, again, I think the reason that I love her pieces is that it was all about form and shape and proportions. And the piece that we chose from Oxford Ceramics today is a vessel with a funnel neck. So it's almost slightly off balance. You don't expect it to work, but it's beautiful to behold. Yeah. And then also the glaze work on it is just, you could stand for hours and just see all the different patination. Yeah. And so I think it just gives hours and hours of enjoyment, really, for me.
No, I can totally see that. And what's interesting is, you know, one's a woven piece for a wall and one's a pot, but they're both, for you, it is the shapes and the forms that you're drawn to.
Yeah, that's really what does it for me, actually, over colour and anything else. It's texture and form that I love,
And what about, can you sort of think of a commission that has been particularly rewarding?
Yes, a couple of years ago we completed a spa area for a client, and we had to work with the existing stone floors because they'd only just installed them. So, and the stone they'd chosen wasn't necessarily something we would choose, but it was it was still whites and greys, so it wasn't too strong a feature. And so what we did was we designed a way of breaking up the corridor with panels, which is lots of us do things like that, pilasters and panels, and so not unusual by any means. But what we did, because the client particularly liked handcrafted pieces, was we had huge panels made and embroidered in India with three-dimensional embroidery with beads, sort of strings of beads and sequins and also within that was a pattern. And so we hung all of these panels, but surrounded them in cut glass borders that had metal trims in between each of them. And then, in addition to that, we used specialist hand painters to paint the walls with an effect and the timber work as well. So we worked with, that's 1, 2, 3, 4 different craftspeople to put that together.
Amazing, because I mean, the kind of effort and the time that takes for you as well as a sort of conductor of the orchestra, I suppose, isn't it?
Yes, yeah.
To bring it all together is also huge, I imagine.
And
lots of drawings.
Yes, yes, lots of drawings and lots of people that you're working with and you hope they've understood.
Good.
And obviously the embroiderers in India, as it happens. And the crystal people were in Czechoslovakia.
Right.
And the specialist hand painters were British. So it was really a culmination of a lot of effort. I find that everybody that was involved in that project took such pride in what they were doing. Mm. I didn't need to add any extra energy because everybody, to the smallest detail, was involved right to the last minute.
Yeah.
And so you get a lot of people that are standing at the end of a project and they're looking back and they know that they did that detail there and you know that you did some small part in it in bringing it together, but actually it's their work.
Yeah.
And to be able to stand with those people and see something like that together as it all comes together, it's a miraculous feeling because it's a brand new design. I mean, nothing is original, but it definitely was something that none of us had done together before.
No.
And it felt amazing.
Yeah, and the energy of all those people and their kind of passion is sort of brings a room alive.
Oh, completely.
It?
I mean, if you can ever get a client to be there when, for example, somebody's painting the walls and they're doing a specialist finish, that the energy increases tenfold because they get excited because they see it coming to life, actually.
Yeah. Do you go with clients to shop for pieces to go
into
their house, sort of once it's finished? And
sometimes we do, actually, because a lot of it you can do beforehand because people can't imagine how the room might look, never mind what to put into it.
Yeah.
So we do take them to different places, maybe a gallery like Willer, or maybe come here to Chris's place and show them pieces in their settings. And I suppose that's another reason why Collect is so good.
Yeah.
All of the people that that have already got an eye, that have gone out and found artists and curated a selection, makes our job a lot easier.
Yeah. And you can educate your client in one sort of hit, can't you, in
That's
a way?
That's so true. Yeah. And also you have people on hand that can talk to you about it. Yeah. So as much as I might be an aficionado of hanging tapestries, I don't necessarily know half of, or even a tenth of what there is to know about it. So I do feel more reassured when there's somebody around to talk us through it, because you don't, otherwise you feel a little bit like a charlatan. I really like it, but you've got nothing else to say. So.
No, exactly. And would you go with a shopping list sort of thing?
With accessories, it's hard because, you know, you don't know what you're going to find, and you might find a great piece and then you don't need much else.
No.
Or sometimes you need hundreds of pieces.
Yeah.
So I think it's better to find the principal pieces with a client, and then you can add to them yourself. Yeah. And then we tend to place them all around, and then the client can come in and then they can say they like things or they don't. And we just take away the things that they don't like. That's probably the nicest shopping experience ever.
Okay.